for the other talk. Please. Okay. So the next talk is about statistics. Again, this is to answer a problem we have currently in DPDK. Okay, I will try to be very quick, and you will ask questions to complete. So for statistic, what do you mean statistic? You know, it's for debugging, monitoring. You need it when you want to check why your performance is not the best one. Which statistic do we have currently? There is one structure which is called RTE ETH stat. In this structure, this is very, very basic. We have only counters for the number of packets, for the number of bytes we receive and we send. And we have also few per queue statistics for the same. Oh, and some errors. So, okay, first question. The problem is that this structure is very badly defined. There are a few comments, but they are not meaningful. For instance, we don't really know which error we are including in these counters. I will better talk later about it. About the counting byte, we don't even know what we are counting. Are we counting CRC or not, etc. And I feel a lot of these statistics are not exactly the same depending on the drivers. But that's an issue which is very well known and also in other projects. Okay, let's move quickly. In this structure, there is a place for per queue statistic, but this is an array. The size of this array is defined at compilation time, and by default, it is 16. Are you okay? You don't use more than 16 queues? It's clearly not enough. And even worse, there is one function to manage the limitation of size, especially because Intel IXGB cannot do more than 60 queue counters. So there is one function which is supposed to map the queue we are really interested in for statistic and the one not. But this function is not used for other devices, and it's even badly used in test PMD to check if we should print the queue statistic or not. Anyway, so the question is: we don't have enough statistic in this structure. Should we add more? Should we add more queue in this array in these structures? So where do we stop? Which statistic do we want to have in the structure or not? What will be the size of the structure if we increase it? What is the performance drawback? Yeah, by the way, is the performance is a concern? That's another question. Performance of getting statistics. Maybe you need it very fast. How much? That's an open question. So I want to talk about another kind of statistic we have in DPDK, which is called extended statistic, XStat. This is pretty the same as the ones you have with ETH tool with Linux drivers. So what is XStat? There is a name for each statistic. There is an ID, a number. A very important thing to note is that this ID is 64 bits. And there is a value, which is also 64 bits. How do you get these statistics? You can query, get all the statistics that the driver, the port, can report. Or you can choose which statistic ID you want to get. And all the basic statistics which are in the whole structure are also reported in this extended statistic API. How we name the extended statistic? That's pretty simple. This is documented with the we have several fields in the name which are separated with underscores. The first first part is RX or TX, then we give more details. If it's a pair Q statistics, we give the Q number of the statistics, and at the end, if it's packets or bytes, etc. You can see examples here for the basic statistic. You can notice that for pair Q statistics, it is not well done. We should have one underscore between the Q number and packet. That's a nice example that we are not able to implement what we document. That's nice. So maybe we should fix it. But it's another API break. So the main issue with XStat is that we have no definition. You remember what is XStat? It is only a name. A name and ID and value. No definition. Okay, you can find some definition in the code of the driver. Nice. But by the way, this XStat are just what the driver can expose. And there is no thinking about how to standardize them, how all drivers can expose the same. Or sometimes they expose the same thing, but not with the same name. More thing. So the proposal is that maybe we should reserve some IDs for the well-known statistics. So this is the first thing. So the ID is known. That's a good advantage. And the other thing is that we can give a precise definition. You know what is a definition in DPDK? This is a very big comment in the code, but a doxygen comment. So it will be reported in the documentation, and the application developer is supposed to read it. And there is no limitation in number of lines. Please, if you define something, take all the line you need and define every cases, every corner cases. There should not be any question left after the definition. Okay, I already talked quickly about the API. We can query all or by ID. So if we have some reserved ID, you don't need to get the ID from the name, by name. So you just know the ID, you query it, it's very fast. And the question is if we want also to reserve some ID for all possible queues, we want to report some statistics. So this is a proposal. We could first, how to split, you remember, there are 64 bits for the XStat ID. So we can use 208 bits just for the very basic stats. Then we can give some driver-specific stats. But how to split it? We can have this scheme for in the first part of the ID for the port statistic, port-wide statistics. And then for pair Q, we can reserve 40 bits. 40 bit. In 40 bits, we can reserve for 16 million of queues. Is it enough? I hope yes. And for 16 million of queues, we can have 64,000 of statistics per queue. So I hope it should be enough. I remember someone already told it would be enough, and he was wrong. So, so there is one issue with changing the IDs of extending statistics like that, is that the IDs are not contiguous. Okay, there is a split, there are several areas. And currently in the API, there is an assumption that all the IDs are contiguous, so the ID is also the index in the array of when we're reporting the ID. It's a small breakage, in my opinion. Okay, so another proposal should be when we use this scheme for extended statistic, then we could deprecate the legacy structure for basic statistic. We don't really want to break again this basic statistic, so let's not touch it. And let's not try to better define this legacy statistic, but focus on the new extended statistic and apply new definition, well-defined, only for extended statistics. And later we can deprecate the legacy one or even remove something to discuss. Okay, now the real question, if we all agree that this API is very good, is which statistics do we want, which counters do we want to standardize? So in order to answer this question, I tried to look at all the standards we have for Ethernet statistics. And one interesting thing in this standard is that they are first discussing counter of 32-bit, and there are also some high capacity counter, but just to remember, in DPDK, we use already 64 bits for every counter, so there is no change here. So a counter of 64 bits, I will take the worst case of today, how we can get use all the 64 bits. The worst case is counting all bytes you receive. If you have a nice Mellanox device at 200 gigs, you will need 23 years to full this counter. And anyway, given how stable is DPDK, it's probably more than enough. So about the standard, I'm sorry if it's a bit boring because there are paper standard and nobody likes to read them, so I read them for you. So there is one which is called Interface MIB. You know, MIB is the standard for SNMP, etc. This is very interesting. Then the Broadband Forum published something which is called TR181, but it is just inspired of the above, so no real need to talk about it. There are a few differences. There is also the Ethernet standard, which is discussing some statistics. And there is a MIB MIB, which is based on it. It is called the Ether-like MIB. So this one is very important. I will talk about it. There is the Remote Monitoring MIB, which is better known as RFC 2819. I don't know why it's better known with this name, but anyway, let's call it Hermon. And there is another very interesting one, which is High Capacity Hermon. It's just to say that you can use a counter of 64 bits, and you can even, if 23 years is not enough for you, you can add another overflow counter of 32 bits. So I want to talk more about it. I think it's not interesting. So we are going to discuss standards. That's mandatory to show this drawing that everybody knows. So there are a lot of standards. Which one to choose? We want to define a new one. Okay, let's do that. So I will talk also about all the implementation we already have because of the multiple standards. No one is implementing strictly one standard. So the better example to check is what is done in Linux netdev, not Linux ETH tool, because ETH tool is just what driver are exposing. But in Linux netdev, you have some basic statistics which are exposed. And also in OVS, that's an interesting use case. So one proposal here is because we are going to define some statistics, we will need to know which statistic is implemented or not by the driver. How to do that? Because the value is 64 bits, we probably won't use the last value, so we can use the maximum value, so we can use it to say we don't implement this statistic. It's not zero, it's not implemented, not available. Okay? So we just reset to zero the statistic we support. No more. That's a proposal. I will try to be very quick. Sorry. First, about CRC, it's interesting to see that Linux and DPDK most of the time are not counting CRC. But all the standards are counting CRC. Probably the explanation is that the standards have a different view of the system, and when we are implementing drivers, we are more interested in payload. Yeah, Stefan is talking about Cisco. Cisco is counting CRC, right? So it's an exception. But anyway, we don't have only physical devices. We have also physical links, physical devices, and in this case, it doesn't make sense to get some CRC. So it's probably better to just standardize on not counting CRC. When counting the total packet you receive, there are two schools. One is to see it from the link layer, and you count everything you receive from the wire, including the bad packets, the errors. Or you have the CPU view from the application, and you see only the packet you really receive in your application. For now, it's not clear in DPDK and Linux which view we prefer to choose. But in standard, in all the MIBs, so you will see in purple, they prefer to see it from the link layer. So they count everything. It's open to discussion. I won't conclude on every statistics. Okay, it's too much boring, I know. I just want to expose a few questions. So that's the same for TX. We can imagine even more questions. You know, there is someone in this room who is already looking closely at all this issue. He's in the back, David Marchand. He told me there are so many to define, for instance. What if we were sending some packet with TSO? Are we counting the original packet or the segmented one? What if there is some offload? What exactly are we counting? That's really hard to define, but clearly we need to do this work. And again, there are different views. In the standard, I found only the Airmon MIB is getting the application view of things. But we just need to choose. Counting the good packets, in general, nobody cares to count only the good packet. Maybe because there is a confusion in the is the total packet number only good packets or not. If we decide to integrate another bad packet in the total, then we need some counters for good packets. Same for TX. So this one is very interesting. In this room, there are people working on OVS too, and maybe they are responsible for integrating the famous RFC 2819 in OVS. So you can see how it is defined in the RFC. You count the packet only per size class, I would say, but the class stop at 1,518 bytes. Okay, but obviously we have bigger packets in DPDK. So what to do? In OVS, there are a few different classes, and one which is defined as max. We will need to standardize exactly which size we want to get, which ranges. There will be big issues here because probably it is already implemented in hardware and it will be hard to change. So, big challenge here. Unicast. Do we want to count only unicast? Currently, no, we are not doing it, but there is one MIB, the interface MIB, which is doing it. Multicast, also, that's the same issue, and same for broadcast. Currently, we are not doing it. You can see that, for instance, in Linux, you will get only the RX multicast packet. Why, I don't know. And for broadcast, there is no such basic counter in Linux NetDev. We can also imagine counting post frames. There is one standard proposing it. You know, this is the kind of thing which can help when debugging some system issues, some system performance. About the errors, so we need to define if we want one counter to count all the errors. We need to define exactly if it's all the errors or only some of them. For instance, for now in DPDK, we are not counting the each time we have a buffer allocation error. This is not really a device error, but it's a software issue, but that's a choice. Linux is counting the same buffer allocation. I think maybe it's RX drop, but not clear because even in Linux NetDev, these statistics are not clearly defined. We need to do it better. One very important counter is the RX mist. This is the counter which tells you, oh, there is a performance issue. I'm not processing fast enough. Probably this one is just to keep. If you receive some packets which have not the right size, it can be another counter. Not sure if it's interesting or not. CRC errors, all the errors you can imagine on Ethernet, alignment error, unsupported protocol, so you don't support all protocols on top of Ethernet. Okay, maybe we need such counter. There are also TX errors. So if you are interested, you can check closely. The slides are available online. Okay. FIFO carriers, all the Ethernet issues, and collisions. There are also standards, especially are talking about how counting collisions. Okay. Conclusion. We are not going to change anything now, because this is big work and we need to agree on all these changes. There are a lot of discussion needed for that. But we need to start discussing it today and be ready for next year, like 2011, because probably we'll have an API breakage window at this time, so we can define our new statistics there. And the other issue is that we need some volunteers to implement all these things. Yes, it's not only discussing, it's also implementing, changing a bit the API and changing all the PMD implementations. All PMD maintainers are concerned here. Don't hide yourself. I see you. Okay, questions? No, it's perfectly clear. There's always one question.
I agree very much. It's a really good idea. I think the waterfall model should be applied. Define the statistics, specify exactly what they are, and then implement them afterwards.
Yes.
When defining the statistics, consider why, how they're going to be used. They're going to, as you said in your introduction, they're going to be used probably, I would say, for two purposes: for performance debugging, but also for some network engineer is having a problem with his network equipment, and he will look at the counters when he is debugging the network. He expects the TX counter to be the same as the RX counter in the other end of the cable. So if some application does some TSO or GSO or whatever, he will expect the counters to be the same. If this box transmitted 27 packets, I expect to see 27 received packets over here. Otherwise, there's a problem with the cable.
Yeah, but it's not the case because you are not using the same device in both runs, right?
Yes, so if I connect DPDK appliance with some NIC to a HP switch, then I expect the RX counter on the switch to be the same as the TX counter on the DPDK appliance.
This is the expectation, yes.
Yes, so that's probably what's built into the standards. Don't implement something because it's in the standards. Reconsider how it's being used and implement for those needs.
Yeah, I totally agree. We need to consider what is useful, basically. What do we need? The thing is that we cannot start such work without looking at what others thought before. So
Yes,
that, 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 that's why it's always interesting to check the standards, but the standards are not all everything. We need to think by ourselves. I agree.
I agree, yeah. Standards are good for inspiration, but they are old.
Yeah. Thank you. Any other question? Okay, there are one more question here, so it looks it's not so boring.
Thank you, Thomas. It's a very good initiative. My question is, do we need to think about more granularity, for example, group of queues, group of ports?
Sorry, I don't get the question.
So I'm thinking about the granularity of the statistics.
Granularity.
Yeah, so for now, we just mentioned the per port
Per
and
port
per
or per
queue.
queue, yeah.
Do we need to think about the group of queues? group of ports.
Group of ports?
Yes.
Oh, that's interesting. I never thought about it. Stefan, you want to comment about it? Yeah. Stefan is an expert of statistics. maybe it's better, can we pass the mic? We have another mic here. Please, can we bring a mic?
So at one point I implemented QStat mapping to map a queue to a flow that I defined with RTE flow so that RTE flow was RSSing over a bunch of queues, and I wanted to know the total aggregate for those queues. So, you know, maybe I was using flows for VM, so each flow was to a VM, and I used the QStat mapping to go VM1's stats.
Yeah, okay. But the question for grouping ports or grouping queues?
I'm saying you could use the QStat mapping.
QStat mapping can solve
it. It doesn't have to be a one-to-one map.
Okay.
So you could do a end-to-one map.
Okay, that's an interesting proposal. We'll need to continue the discussion on mailing list. We are very late, so I hope there is no more question, but you are welcome to raise your hand. Okay. Thank you, everybody.